Hello everybody and welcome to yet another Python Plays a GTA 5 tutorial. In this tutorial what we're going to be doing is just kind of building off the last one. The last one we proved that yes, we can actually stream this game to OpenCV slash Python at a rate of about 10 frames a second. Also, just in case that's not you, like for example, if you're on like a, if you're on any computer that can play GTA 5, I feel like you should, unless your computer's horribly imbalanced, have a processor that can stream that image back. So I'm playing Grand Theft Auto 5 in an it's 800 by 600. As long as you have a computer that can normally play Grand Theft Auto 5 at full screen on like high settings, you should have probably a processor that can stream Grand Theft Auto 5 at like 10 frames a second, which to be honest, it's actually pretty impressive now that I'm like thinking about it, because I'm almost positive that all of OpenCV is actually on the CPU, so that the CPU can play Grand Theft Auto 5 at 10 frames a second is actually kind of cool. Anyway, the next thing that I want to cover here is, so we used OpenCV to, all we've done is actually used OpenCV to, we did convert the color, but we also are really just using it to show the window. So we haven't really seen that, sure, we could do some manipulations on this and not sacrifice like 5 frames a second. Okay, so the next thing we need to really test is whether or not we can actually do OpenCV stuff on this data. So just in case you're not familiar, you don't have to go through this series, but if you want to reference some stuff with OpenCV, you can go to pythonprogramming.net, data analysis, image and video analysis, and bada boom. And then this is just a bunch of stuff that we can do with OpenCV. This is just a bunch of examples. But if you want to kind of get comfortable with doing things, and especially like masks and regions of interest, you might want to check out OpenCV, the tutorials. Anyway, so the first thing that we're going to do is just kind of do some typical processing of the actual screen that we're pulling here. So I think what I'll do is eventually we'll get rid of this print, just because actually the act of printing, especially in idle, is especially over a long period of time, is going to negatively impact our frames a second. So you won't want to always have that there, especially if you're running in idle. If you're running through like a command prompt or terminal or something like that, it won't be as impactful, and you could leave it there for like debugging purposes. Let's go ahead and do some real OpenCV tasks. So I'm going to define process underscore image, and then we'll pass image into it. And then we're just going to say the original image equals image. So the reason why we're doing this is, and in fact, we probably could just leave it as image, but I like the name original image so it's clear, but we are kind of duplicating things. I could call this original image. I could change that. We could do original image like that. Then we're not copying that image, actually. Okay, we'll do that. So we'll call it original image. Now what we're going to say is processed image. So why are we doing this? So eventually, what happens when you a typical kind of workflow with OpenCV is you have an original image, and then you dumb that image down crazy to, like, do something like find edges, or even more dumb, like in our case, what we're going to do is we're going to attempt to use OpenCV to find lanes in a road. So as you do that, you're going to simplify that image so much so that eventually you just have 2 lanes, right? But then what we kind of want to be able to do is take those 2 lanes and put them back on the real original image. So you always kind of want to save the original image. Original or process image now will be cv2.convert color. We want to convert the color of original image. I'm pretty confident that doesn't happen in place. We're going to find out. But anyway, hopefully it doesn't. Anyway, cv2.color. And then this will be bgr2gray. We're converting to gray because we want to have much simpler data. So BGR is, an array of values from 0 to 255, right? So it's 3 values per pixel. Whereas with gray is simply a, each pixel is a single value. It's obviously much simpler, and we can feed that directly through, you know, a convolutional neural network or something, if it comes to that. Initially, though, my plan is to try to use OpenCV and more like rules first before we try to, you know, throw. You can't just throw neural networks at things. That's not how it works. So I'd like some sort of way to determine whether or not we are in a lane. And even if we're not 100%, like even if we don't have 100% perfection at that, what we can do is every time we have two lanes that we're very confident are two lanes, we can take that data and save that data to later train a neural network. So anyway, that's why we're doing that. The other option too is to just play Grand Theft Auto for like a few hours, especially like if we just drive the same road over and over, and then take the image data and then the input that we made as we drove that road and train a neural network off that. That's possible to do. And in fact, just recently I saw NVIDIA released a thing where you can actually do that. Like NVIDIA will log basically what you've done, and then you can train a model to play the game like you play it. So I'm very curious about that. I wonder how much training data it really takes, but interesting concept. So anyway, back to what we're doing. Process image, so we converted it to gray. Now what we're going to go ahead and do is just do like some typical canny edge detection. So we can say we're going to just keep the processed image. Processed image equals cv2.canny. And here we pass the processed underscore image. And then you have two thresholds. So we'll say threshold 1 equals 200. And then threshold 2 equals 300. You can tweak these numbers. Probably a lot is going to depend on the game. A lot will depend on just so many things. So this will be tweakable for sure. Now let's go ahead and return the processed underscore image. And now what we're going to do is under screen, we'll keep that happening. And in fact, under screen, we'll do this. So we're going to say now new screen equals process image. Original image. And then now, rather than showing the original screen, this one, we'll just comment this out. Eventually we are going to show pretty much the original screen with some new things drawn on it, so I want to keep that there. But for now we're actually just going to do cv2.imshow, and we'll call this we can call this window. And let's just call this window 2 before we forget. Window, and then cv2 dot, actually we don't need to convert anything. Let's just do new screen. Cool. All right. Let's save that and let's run that and see how we're doing up to this point. Move this out. Up. New screen, process image, original image. Nope, we need to process screen. Derp. Again, beautiful. So here we have the edge detection. So this is a little unfortunate. I wish I could make this. I'm not sure why this is so big. Maybe we'll have to resize this to 8. I guess 8.6. Because what's happening is my monitor is a 4K monitor. So this is real 800x600. This is a scaled 800x600 to like fit the monitor, because the monitor does auto scaling. Oh dear, what have I done? Come back! Oh, we've been trolled by Windows Shake. let me pull up the script again. There we go. And again, actually, we're still seeing 10 frames a second, which is actually really exciting for me. I'm very glad that we're still hitting that. Anyway, we have edges. Beautiful, beautiful. Can you imagine playing GTA just with edge detection? That would be pretty brutal. But yeah, we still are operating a really good frames a second. So very cool, very cool. Now, the last thing that we need to do is a thing that I kind of put off initially. And again, I know the solution, right? And that is sending input to the game.